Hey there everybody, it's Mark Crowley. I'm back with another video. This is number 23 in my ongoing series of question and answer videos, formerly known as Message to My Subscribers videos. And as you can see, today I'm going to be working on a drawing of Rapunzel from the Disney animated film Tangled. And just sort of preparing, I might do a how to draw video on this topic at some point, but I thought it might be fun for you to see me preparing, practicing. As I work on this. But enough of the jibber-jabber. Let's get on with the questions and answers. And the first one comes to us from Joe Davies. When you were a child, what did you draw more, cartoons or real life? And do you think it affected you as an artist? Well, happily, I've got some videos in which I actually show drawings from my elementary school years, and those of you who have seen those videos will recall that they are mainly cartoony drawings. I don't know if I would call the majority of them sort of realistic-looking drawings. Like any kid, I loved cartoons. I loved making silly drawings. I loved making fantasy drawings. As far as like doing still life illustrations, highly realistic illustrations, those were, you know, I did those as well, but they were probably comparatively few and far between. And to me, the interesting thing about this question from Joe is, do you think it affected you as an artist? And I just wanted to say, you know, a lot of people sometimes equate realistic drawing with good drawing. Cartoony drawing is not as good, some people will say, or they are under the impression of that. And so you might think, boy, if you did a lot of cartoony drawings rather than highly realistic drawings, that might sort of impede your progress as an artist or hold you back or something like that. And, you know, in my experience, that is not the case. I think that there's nothing wrong with doing a lot of cartoony drawings as a kid or indeed throughout your life. And that you should sort of open your mind to not think that realistic drawing is the only way. Now, it so happens that I did pursue learning how to draw in a realistic way. I used to go to the Detroit Institute of Arts on Saturdays, would do drawings of sculptures and paintings, and by the time I got to college, especially, I had a great mentor in the form of children's book illustrator David Small, who encouraged me to study the works of the masters like Da Vinci and Rembrandt and so forth. I've talked about this before, but certainly when you're studying that kind of thing, you are learning realistic drawing. And, for me, I'm glad that I did that. But I hesitate to say that that's the path for everyone. I suppose I could say this, that if you want to draw professionally, it is not a bad idea to learn how to draw things realistically. But, you know, to sort of swing back to the question at hand, I, as a child, did a lot of cartoony drawing, and I don't think it held me back. Drawing is drawing in a lot of ways. I think what's going to hold you back is not drawing at all. I was pretty obsessed with it and was drawing in lots of different styles all day long, all the time, and I would say that's part of the key to me getting better at it. Let's move on to the next question, and this is going to be an interesting one. The question comes from Razvan Dan, or Don, I'm not really sure how to pronounce this, and the question is, greetings from Spain, what kind of music do you listen to? Now, those of you who've watched these videos of mine before, you may say, hey, Mark, you answered that question 2 or 3 years ago. I don't know if there's anyone who remembers that far back, but indeed I did. I was asked this question before, but I thought of a new way of answering it that would be kind of interesting, and that is to play for you an example of the kind of song that I like. And, well, you know, there's issues of copyright when it comes to playing music on YouTube, and so what I did is I reached out to a singer-songwriter that I admire by the name of Elizabeth Zimmern. Her band is called Elizabeth and the Catapult. And asked her for permission. Is it okay if I play a portion of one of your songs to let my viewers know what kind of music I like? And she very graciously has allowed me to do that. So first, let me just show. I'm going to splice in here a photo of Elizabeth, so you kind of get a sense of who she is. And that is the wonderful Elizabeth Zeman. I'm going to talk a little more about her in a second, but let's go ahead and play this piece of music. It's called Taller Children, and certainly I love this particular song, and it will sort of introduce you to the type of music that I enjoy. So let's go ahead. I'm going to keep drawing as I play this, go ahead and hear the first half or so of this piece of music, Taller Children by Elizabeth and the Catapult.
Just taller children, we're all just taller children. We're all just taller children, we're all just taller children.
So you think you know, think you know, think you know better. Is it just because you're older and wiser? Don't you know, don't you know, you don't get smarter. You're the same as you started, you just jump a little higher.
So there you have it, Taller Children by Elizabeth and the Catapult. And I don't know exactly what you call that style of music, pop music. That's such a wide open term. To me, really, my main influence as a child was the music of the Beatles, and have always loved, of course, the Beatles music, but anything that sort of follows in the footsteps of the Beatles. And when I discovered the music of Elizabeth and the Catapult, I was like, all right, now this is my kind of music. Because you get the great melody, you get the great singing, you get the interesting lyrics, it's all together in one wonderful package in terms of the music from my point of view. And the added sort of delightful thing after discovering the music is I discovered that Elizabeth herself is very responsive to her fans, you know, and she'll reply to you. She'll, you know, like, if you tweet to her, she will reply. You know, not every single time. None of us in the internet world can reply every single time, but she does periodically. And, you know, compared to other musicians, way more, I find, than other musicians. So she's really there for you as a fan, which is a wonderful added thing. But even if she didn't do that, I would just love the music. I mean, that's the basis of it. And so, yes, thank you, Elizabeth, for allowing me to play that sample of your music there. And that hopefully is a more interesting way of answering that question. Well, let's move on to number three here from Diana Jo Harry. Do you think the brand of pencils affects the outcome of the artwork? Now, those of you, again, who know me, you know that I try to de-emphasize the drawing materials. I think people get a little hung up on that. Certainly the brand. If you mean, by when you say brand, you mean the company, the manufacturer. I don't believe that you have to have one particular brand of pencils, no. But there certainly are differences in quality between what you would buy at an art store and what you would buy at the corner drugstore kind of a place. There's really very cheap disposable pencils. You know, if you can buy 20 pencils for like 99 cents, I think you can be pretty sure those are not the finest quality pencils. And those probably are not going to serve you very well. But by the same token, people know that this is a black Prismacolor colored pencil. I really don't want people to think, oh, it's got to be a Prismacolor. You got it. If it's not Prismacolor, just throw it away. No, I don't believe that. And the other pencil that I use quite a lot is the Dixon Ticonderoga. But again, I don't feel like, oh, you got to absolutely have that pencil. The main thing is to get, you know, quality art materials, with pencils in particular, the main thing is the difference between the softness and the hardness of the graphite. And especially as I've gotten older, I've noticed that that makes a big difference. And some people are asking me, how do you stop from smearing your pencil lines? Well, part of it is to use a pencil that's not super soft. This is the H, the number 3. And then let me see if I can find another one, the HB. HB is going to be a little softer. This H is going to be harder. But again, I'm not sure if that system goes throughout the entire world. People may have different ways of, I don't know if every pencil has that H or HB system, or even the 2 or the 3. I think really the main thing is to try them out and find out what works best for you. What works for me might not work for you. And so it comes down to personal preference. That's why, again, you know, I feel like I'm just hedging all over the place here, but I don't, I certainly don't want people to think they need to buy the materials that I use in particular. Or indeed, even the type, as I said, like the H or the number 3, that one is actually a little hard. The HB, if you want to do shading, in my experience, is a little better. It softens up and more of the graphite comes down on the page. But if you have a super soft pencil and then your finger goes over it, ooh, yeah, it's going to smear all over the place and your drawing may turn into a bit of a mess. So, anyway, hopefully that was a decent answer. A halfway decent answer for that question. And let's move on to the next one from Leo Stewart. Are there any scenes from Brody's Ghost that didn't make it to the finished product? Now, for those of you who don't know, I do a graphic novel series for Dark Horse called Brody's Ghost. And love this question because it allows me to indeed sort of think back to my early plans for the story and if there was something that didn't make it in. And there is actually a fairly interesting, I don't want to go into too much length, I don't want to go into this at length because I'm not sure everyone watching this video even knows the Brody's Ghost story, but for those of you who do, you know, Brody discovers that he has the ability to see and talk to ghosts, which in the world that I've imagined is an extremely rare trait. Very, very few people possess that ability. And I had an idea at one point in the story that the ghost, Talia, the female ghost that is the main ghost character in the story, at one point that she would take him, she would reveal to him that he was not the first ghost seer that she had tried to work with, that there was another ghost seer that she had discovered before, and that she would take him to meet this guy, and you would find that he had basically completely lost his mind, and that he was, you know, I guess I wanted to introduce this element of, you know, using this ability of ESP or whatever to talk to ghosts might actually cause you brain damage over time. And it would introduce this element of risk, you know, that Brody, by, you know, training himself and learning to speak with ghosts and so forth, he might be endangering himself. And of course, he, you know, your character becomes more heroic that way. So I did have this idea, and I'm sorry, a little sad that I wasn't able to work it in. It wasn't super necessary for the plot, but I thought that would have been an interesting scene for Brody to see someone else who had kind of followed the path that he was on to disastrous consequences. And so, yeah, that answers that question. There was indeed at least one scene that didn't make it into the final Brody's Ghost. Let's move on to question number 5 here from Isabel Pumphrey. Is watching your videos, doing the drawings, and then turning them in for an art project cheating? Interesting question. And, you know, I'd say if you follow line by line one of these videos that I have done, and your drawing looks essentially exactly like the drawing that I did, and then you hand it in without acknowledging that to your teacher, yeah, I would say that is cheating. Well, at the very least, it's being very dishonest because you're presenting it as if you did this all by yourself. You should at least let the teacher know I followed a video on YouTube to get this result. So I'm sorry if that's not the answer you wanted to hear, but I do indeed believe I mean, there's nothing wrong with following these videos. I mean, I wouldn't be doing them if I felt there was something wrong with it. But you do have to be honest about what it is that you're doing. These are exercises, and you can't claim authorship over the illustration 100%. If indeed you followed in a very line-by-line way my videos. Now, that being said, I see a lot of drawings by people that are sort of based a little bit on my videos, but then they've started to change things, and so that there's sort of a gray zone there where you essentially make it your own. Again, I'd say in the interests of complete honesty, you should maybe point out that the basis of this drawing came from a video. But I've seen some that are essentially completely different drawings, and people say, thanks, this video of yours helped me out in doing this drawing, and yet I can't really see necessarily exactly what it was. You know, I mean, they're completely different drawings. In that case, there's no need to fess up to having got some help from the video, because it is so drastically different. But I thought that was an interesting question, and who knows? So there will be maybe different opinions on this one, the degree to which it's cheating or being dishonest to present one of these illustrations without acknowledging that it came from one of my videos. Okay, next question, number 6. And boy, what a big question this is. This one comes from Reiko Sama. How do you write the middle of the story? How do you write the middle of the story? That is really something, because, you know, the middle of the story is the meat of the story. That's the huge, big, long section. In many ways, I would say the beginning of the story is the easiest to write. It's very clear what you're doing. You're introducing your character. You're introducing the world. You are generally setting up ordinary life, showing the reader, this is ordinary life before, dun, 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 something extraordinary happened. And, you know, the reason for that is simple. You are providing context. Otherwise, the extraordinary thing doesn't seem so extraordinary. We want the reader to know what was ordinary life like, and then there's the contrast when the extraordinary thing happens that unleashes the story. Then, of course, the ending is tricky, but at least you know what you're trying to do. You're trying to wrap up all the loose ends in a way that is hopefully surprising, but certainly the main thing is to make it satisfying, and you at least know what you're trying to do. This question from Reiko-sama, how do you write the middle of the story? That is really quite a huge question and probably beyond me answering, but I'd say it comes down to creating a series of gradually escalating obstacles. And in the interest of making it specific, you know, Brody in Brody's Ghost is charged with discovering the identity of a murderer. And he has these sort of latent powers of ESP that he should be able to use to help him discover who the murderer is. Well, if I had him sort of miraculously unlock the powers right away, discover the name and address of the murderer, and then just run out and get him, that's not a story. It's not interesting. So, of course, I decided he needs to first unlock the powers. So that's hopefully an interesting series of events as he undergoes training to begin to gradually release the powers and master them. And then, you know, as you would imagine with any kind of a sort of mystery, you are gradually releasing the clues and then little by little allowing the reader and your main character to discover things little by little, working your way towards the end of the story. I mean, it's such a huge question to answer. How do you write the middle of the story? But hopefully that gives you some basic idea of what your goal is. I think there should be one or two twists in there, at least. Basically, you know, until you start just sitting down and imagining those scenes, you really don't know how the story's going to go. You can maybe sketch out the basics of it, but I think you have to kind of put yourself into your character, go into that room with your character, start writing the dialogue, And that's when the story kind of, you know, it doesn't exactly tell itself, but, you know, one little detail that you came up with leads to another, and before you know it, you are thinking of new ideas that you hadn't thought of at the outset. And, you know, the prime goal is make it more interesting. I know in Pixar they call it plussing it. You have to plus this scene. You have to add more stuff to it to make it more interesting. And they are masters of doing that. And I try to do the same thing. I'm trying to always, what is the most interesting way of presenting this scene, of presenting this line of dialogue? There's, you know, can I make it less cliche? Can I make it more fresh? Anyway, boy, I could go down the rabbit hole of storytelling for the rest of the video, but unfortunately, I can't do that. Let's move on to the next one from Misaki Scribble. Did any of your art ever get destroyed in any way? And I hope that I haven't answered this one before. I hope I haven't. But there are two different examples of my art kind of getting destroyed. Destroyed is maybe not the right word, but losing my art. I was in Germany years ago when I was in college, traveling through Europe. It was really kind of an amazing experience. I was doing drawings everywhere I went. In my sophomore year of college, I was going to be graded or given credit for this series of drawings that I did on site in various European countries. And at one point, when I was in Germany, I left my sketchbook on the train. And only discovered after I had got off the train that I'd left that sketch. I mean, there were like, I would think 20, maybe 20 or 30 completed, highly polished pencil drawings. And we went to the lost and found, but it never did turn up. And so I don't know what became of that sketchbook. Who knows? Maybe it will suddenly, you know, some German person will step forward and say, I found this. On the train, back in 19, when was that? 85, I think it was. And it must be yours, Mark Crilly. Wouldn't that be wild? Talk about a twist. Plot twist. Somebody watching this video knows where that's... I'm afraid probably it just got thrown away, you know, by someone cleaning out the train or something. Who knows? The other thing, and I'll just go through this quickly. When I was in college, I made this gigantic banner that was advertising this play, or this musical that we were doing called Fear and Loathing in the Third Reich, and made this gigantic banner that was hanging outside the Fine Arts Building of Kalamazoo College, where I went to college. And somebody in the middle of the night came along and tore it down and absconded with that thing that I'd spent hours working on this thing. And again, who knows? Who knows what became of it? Probably thrown away. But it's kind of like vandalism, really, right? Hey, man, let's yank that thing down. And there was no reason for doing it. But I have my vengeance by imitating their voice on this video. Hey, man, look at that banner. Oh, yeah, I got back at them, didn't I? Anyway, let's move on to the next question, number 8. If Mickey Falls or Brody's Ghost were to be adapted into an animated TV movie series and you could pick who would voice act them, who would your ideal choices be? That question coming from Bishi Wover. And that's a great question and interesting. And I should just say, just for the sake of reality, if this ever happens, if I am ever so lucky to have any of my stories adapted, turned into movie or TV show, animated or otherwise, I'm pretty sure that I will have no control over that process at all. They don't tend to allow the writers, the authors, unless you are J.K. Rowling, you don't have that degree of power to say, well, I want this voice actor, I want that. Most of us, and by us I mean the, you know, humble comic book creators or whatever, once they buy the rights, they pay you something, and that's what you get. You get that money. You don't get the control over what happens after that. Anyway, but it is sort of fun to sort of imagine in a playful way, who would I choose? And I have come up with two answers, one for Miki, my main character in Miki Falls, and one for Brody, the main character in Brody's Ghost. And for Miki, in my ideal world, I would love to have Amanda Seyfried, who did the voice of Mary Catherine in the animated film Epic. Don't know if any of you have seen that film. I thought it was quite a charming film, and I thought Amanda especially did wonderful voice acting for that main character. And so I think she would make a great voice actor for doing Miki. Of course, the Miki is supposed to be Japanese, so, you know, I guess she should be speaking in Japanese, but let's just assume that if it ever does get turned into an animated film, it'll be probably made by Americans, and so the original voice would be in English. And I think Amanda would do an amazing job there. And for the voice of Brody, let's go straight to the top. I'm going to request Chris Pine, who did the voice of Jack Frost in Rise of the Guardians. He was good at doing this sort of dark, troubled character, which is a little bit the way Brody is for most of the series. And, you know, Chris Pine, he's Captain Kirk in the new Star Trek films. Guy's a little busy, I think, and probably not necessarily going to have time for doing an animated Brody's Ghost voice acting gig. But hey, like I said, I'm just doing this for fun, playing around with who would the ideal people be. And so there you go. See if we can get Amanda Seyfried and Jack Frost. Jack Frost? We can get Jack Frost. Chris Pine to do the voice acting. Whew. Clearly, I need to move on to the next question. Number 9, from Maliha Sayed. Hope I'm saying that right. Do you ever feel pressured that you have to always upload your videos on a Friday? And, you know, really, I have to begin this saying, when it comes to these YouTube videos, I feel nothing but gratitude, really, to be in the position that I am of having videos that are watched by thousands of people. I feel incredibly lucky to have sort of stumbled into this world where I'm able to do that. You know, I can take some of the credit for having built it up myself by creating quality videos, but let's face it, you know, there's a lot of people out there who are also creating super high quality videos that don't get watched. And you always have to acknowledge, I think, in these things, the luck of having been in the right place at the right time to have built up this audience gradually over time. I think right now, if you try to start a How to Draw channel, it's much, much harder to build up an audience than it was, because I got in there almost within the first year of YouTube's existence. I don't know if everybody knows that. 2007, I think, was when I started doing videos, and I believe 2006 was when YouTube started. So yeah, I was right in there at the beginning, and I think that made all the difference in terms of being able to build up this audience. So anyway, to answer the question, do I ever feel pressure about uploading a video, a new video every week? Well, I came up with that new video every Friday promise. I did that to myself. I made that decision to keep to a regular schedule. I think it helps people. I know I like a podcast that comes out every week. So I knew that people would like a YouTube channel where the video would come out at least once every week. So that's self-inflicted. I can't complain about it. I can't talk about, oh, the pressure. You know, to be 100% honest, yeah, it's not easy, especially when I've got other work to do. I do public speaking. Of course, I'm doing the books, which take a lot of time. There are times when I need a little bit of a break, and you can probably notice those are the weeks when I do a video that's, you know, like showing the old drawings from elementary school. Hopefully not a completely worthless video. There's some value to that video, but let's face it, I didn't have to draw anything. I mean, or I did, but I did it back when I was in elementary school. And I'm just sort of sifting through these old drawings. So, you know, every once in a while I will allow myself a little bit of a week off, a week's rest in that sense, a video that doesn't require quite as much time and effort as a How to Draw video. But no, certainly I would never say I'd feel pressured. Like I said at the beginning, I feel very lucky. I'm delighted that I'm able to do this. And I enjoy, and really enjoy it. I enjoy making these videos. It's fun. And now we come to number 10, the last of the what I would call the real questions before we move on to the lightning round. This question coming from Nozomi Girl Original. Have you ever considered going back and redoing some of your earlier work? And that is a great question. In fact, what I'm going to do is I'm going to hit the pause button because I want to show you an actual mistake in Brody's Ghost that I will hopefully have the chance to remedy. It made it all the way through into the published book. And so hang on a second, I'll be right back. All right, so this is from Brody's Ghost, book two. And hopefully it's not too spoilery, but there is this scene where Brody is using his powers of telekinesis. Is that what it's called? Telekinesis? You can mind over matter, you can make objects move with your brain. And I'm going to go in until this blurs and then go back, and then we'll know we're about as close as we can be. All right. So he's using this to make headphones, earbuds, go weave their way around the neck of this gang leader. And unfortunately, it's not there in this panel. Oops! That was a complete mistake. I should have drawn it in that panel. I can't believe it made it all the way through to the printed book, and I do feel bad about that. Maybe it's hiding, right? It's sort of hiding back behind him. But I do hope that if there is ever a collected volume of the Brody's Ghost series, I can go back and fix that mistake. So yeah, there's the question. What was it? Have you ever considered going back and redoing some of your earlier work? I will definitely be going back to fix that mistake. But in terms of like redoing, you know, entire sections of Meeky Falls or something like that, no, I didn't. Never look back. Isn't that what what's her name in the? In the Incredibles. I never look back, darling. It takes me out of the now. I could not imagine going back and completely redoing, whole sections of an earlier work. It just, that seems too laborious. And I really would rather spend my time doing something new. As I always will be doing, sometimes people ask, are you going to do some other books after Brody's Ghost? And the answer is, of course, absolutely. I will never stop doing books. Hopefully, right up until the day I die, I intend to continue doing books. I love doing them. And so you can count on a non-stop stream of books coming from me in the years ahead, so long as people allow to keep publishing them. So anyway, it is now time to move on to the ever-popular lightning round. Now the lightning round, hang on a second, I'm going to actually go back and refocus so that you can see the whole drawing. So the lightning round is the part where I answer the sort of silly questions that are not meant to be taken too seriously, and they are basically from 1 to 10 some of the goofiest questions I saw posted on the earlier video, but I enjoy throwing them in at the end of each one of these videos. People seem to enjoy them. But you know what I'm going to do even before I get to that? I am going to, in time-lapse, add more shading to this drawing, because I would like the drawing to be done by the time I finish this video. So I'm going to cheat a little right now. We're going to do some time-lapse, and then we will get on to the lightning round. All right, well, I basically tried to almost carry it all the way through to completion because the truth is when I do this lightning round, there's I'm moving so quickly through the questions, there's really not that much time to draw. So I figured I would finish almost everything except just this little area of hair right here, which I think needs quite a bit more shading. So let's go ahead now and finally move on to the lightning round. And the first question comes from Cuppycakes 2002. Why don't we have wings? Why do human beings not have wings? I think it's because if we had wings, then all the birds would have arms instead of wings, and then they would all fall to the ground. They would be stumbling around with little humanoid arms, and that would just be, that would freak everyone out. So that I think that answers that question quite well, don't you? Let's go on then to number two here. What is Brody's last name? That question comes from Final Lugia Guardian. You know, that's funny because actually I've never really thought of what his last name is. And I've done that with a number of my characters over the years. They have a first name, they have no last name. And that is sort of a weird habit of mine. But wouldn't it be funny if it was some kind of weird, really long German name? Von Grimmelhausen. My name is Brody von Grimmelhausen. Why does every time an American tries to do a German accent, it sounds like Schwarzenegger, who is from Austria? My apologies to both the people of Austria and Germany for that terrible accent. Let's move on quickly to number three. If you work for 20,000 hours nonstop, would you get tired of drawing and feel like destroying everything? That question from Rebecca He, I believe, if that's a Chinese name. Hope I'm saying that correctly. You know, I had to then use the internet to figure out that 20,000 hours comes out to 2 years and around 4 months. Working nonstop? I think I would be dead after the first, what, three, 4 days? Lack of sleep. Sorry to take the question so literally, but certainly I would get tired not only of drawing, but of living if I even attempted 20,000 hours nonstop. Let's move on to this question from I Am a Graphic Girl. I know you love Star Wars. Are you excited for the new films by J.J. Abrams? I am. Was not a super huge fan of those prequels, but I do believe, I have great faith in the Star Wars universe for all kinds of great stories to be told. You know, I mean, if they can do, what is it, 23, 24 James Bond films, some of them good, some of them not so great, I think they could do the same with Star Wars, fingers crossed. Not just for the J.J. Abrams, but for all the different Star Wars films they're planning to do in the years ahead. On to the next one by John Miller. Am I a good tree? Well, John, assuming that you typed those words on a keyboard and then posted them into the comment section of YouTube, I'm going to say no, you are not a good tree. But you are probably an excellent human being, so far as I can tell. So, the questions I get, people, I can't explain them. Let's move on to the next one from Sarah White. Do you agree with the idea of Waffle Wednesday? Sure, I agree with that. In fact, I'm sure that the waffle manufacturers love that idea. They probably want it to be Waffle Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So yeah, how can anyone really be against that idea? Let's go on now to number seven. If I hit myself and it hurts, am I weak or am I strong? This question from Equi the Man. I'm going to say you're strong. I'm going to say you're strong. If you are able to hit yourself hard enough to feel pain, then you must be strong. In fact, you know, actually feeling pain is not indicative of lack of strength. Strong people feel the pain, man. They feel the pain. They just fight through it. That is the sign of strength, man. What is with me? Way too much coffee today. Let's move on. We only got three more to go. This one from Matilda Anderson. Possibly the goofiest question I've ever answered in any one of these questions. Matilda asks, do insects fart? you know, what? Are they going to hold it in their entire lives? I mean, granted, their lives are not that long, but still, I'm going to say yes, they do, probably, but that's out of complete ignorance relating to insects. Let's speed onward to the second to last question. This is from Mayo the Random, unless it's Mio the Random. All in caps, were you the one who stole my cookies? No, I was not the one who stole your cookies. I wasn't even there that day. I resent the accusation. And those cookies had raisins, and they were about 3 days old. So there's no way that I would have stolen those cookies. Finally, number 10. Can I shake your hand and absorb some of your skills? This question from Ankoku Shadows. I don't believe that the acquisition of skills works that way, but who knows? If I ever meet you, let's shake hands, and we will find out. Well, folks, that brings us to the end of this video. I really hope you enjoyed it. Please leave in the comment section if you would like to see me do an actual step-by-step video about how to draw Rapunzel. By all means, just say so, because I certainly can do that. Probably not right away. Otherwise, people will see, you know, people will think that I'm obsessed for some reason with Rapunzel. But certainly, I'd be happy to do such a video at some point in the future. But let's go ahead and lay down this pencil. I want to thank you all for watching this video. I really hope you enjoyed it. I know I did. And I'll be back with another one real soon.